Henrik Palmgren. Thank you for tuning in to Red Ice Radio, redicecreations.com. It is lovely to have you with us wherever you are. We have a little bit of a late Yule present for you today, as we are going to do an extended segment, our second program, as promised, in our mini-series with John Lash from metahistory.org, author of Not in His Image. He is with us to expand on the latest program that we did on white genocide and the archontic infection. And this time, it's to announce the Kalika War Party. Mr. Lash, good to have you with us once again. I know that a lot of our listeners have been in the mood for our second program, and it's been a while, but you know, you've had some things in the works and things have lined up now, so this is a good time as any to do it. So welcome back, John.
Well, thanks. It's good to be with you again.
Absolutely. We have, of course, a lot of good stuff that we talked about last time, and we're going to, you know, kind of take that next step in that process and discuss a little bit more about what to do about some of the things we did address and how to begin to interact with this in a different way. And you have come to an idea here. You wanted to build something up that you call the Kalika War Party as a means to get into this. Tell us about how you got this idea and what this means.
Well, I think, first of all, it would be good if I said what it means to me personally. I can't say what it may come to mean to anyone who listens to this interview, or whether it may come to mean something of an enduring impact in anyone's life, but I can't say. I'm taking a very big gamble with something. But I can say at the outset, because I do like to be totally transparent, that the Kalika War Party is really the culmination of my entire life. And so this is a big moment for me to be talking with you, recording this, and to be using Red Ice and having the opportunity to use Red Ice to announce the Kalika War Party. It seems like I was reflecting on it this evening, you know, downstairs with the cats in front of the fire. It's a nice, cool, clear winter night here in Spain. The sky is like obsidian stone.
Lovely.
With diamonds encrusted in it. And I was sitting in the before the fireplace in the salon. I was thinking about you, Red Ice, and when we first got together, and it's like 5 or 6 years now we've been talking to each other.
Many years ago. Yeah.
Yeah. And of course, I think we started out, well, certainly we did, with an emphasis on Gnosticism because of my profile as a Gnostic scholar. Okay. You know, self-educated Gnostic scholar. And then, of course, we went right into the Archon material, and I think we did a couple or three talks on that.
Yeah.
Relating it to transhumanism, things like that.
That's right. Yeah.
Yeah. And of course, you've been extremely helpful to me with the Red Ice broadcasts, which have been decisive in getting out the Archon intel. And I think it's largely due to you that people now recognize that I'm the person that introduced that term into the discourse. So we've come a long ways, and what we're going to talk about tonight is of absolute paramount importance to me. And I'm grateful that you're at the other end of the line. You are, as far as I know, right now in my life, the most appropriate person to be having this conversation with.
Thank you, John. I appreciate that. And as you know, we've been very glad to be able to facilitate that. And of course, you know, going through a lot of this work with you. So we're always very pleased that that you want to come back and return to us and do these types of shows, because I think it's really important. And it takes things to that kind of next level, a deeper level to understand the both the complexity, but the problems in the world as well. So I think it's really appropriate, you know.
Well, sure. And you know, we're not just talking and making words and making sounds about one subject or another, but we're building continuity here. You and I have built some continuity, and for one thing, as we already discovered in our last interview in August, one result of that continuity is that it has brought us simultaneously to the same point. Simultaneously, although on the different paths of our lives, your life in working in one way, mine developing in another way, brought us simultaneously to the issue of the white genocide agenda.
That's right.
Yeah. So what I'm going to say tonight ties in very closely with that agenda. And it's the place to start, I would say, is where we left off with that talk in August. I believe that I said at the end of the talk that I would like to start the next talk on the subject of Parsifal. Was that true? I think that was the case.
As a warrior, as a knight?
Yes, yeah. As a warrior and as something else as well. So I'd like to start out, I'd like to lead in to answering your question, namely, how did I come to create this entity called the Kalika War Party? And I'd like to do that by way of talking about Parsifal and the legend of Parsifal. So here goes. You know, Joseph Campbell was a comparative mythologist. I think he died in 1986. You certainly know who he is, and I think he's fairly well known in among the planetary intelligentsia, I would just say.
Yeah, I think so. Definitely he's one of the bigger names, yeah.
Yeah. Well, you know, I've been compared to him. I never compare myself to him, by the way, but I don't make that claim. But other people have made that comparison simply because we both deal with the same material. That is to say, we are comparative mythologists. And they are relatively rare on the planet. Merce Eliade was also a comparative mythologist. And a comparative mythologist is different from the ordinary mythologist who graduates from some university, whether it be of Stockholm University or the Sorbonne or Harvard or Stanford. I guess they're still graduating mythologists once in a while. But most mythologists are really specialized. They will only discuss one subject area, whether it be Greek mythology, Celtic, Chinese, or whatever. It is, after all, a hugely diverse field of material. But a comparative mythologist, such as myself, ranges over all of the different cultures and looks at all the different mythological themes and complexes and narratives and compares them. So Joseph Campbell, who was arguably the greatest comparative mythologist in the world at the end of his life in 1986, made a signal statement in a book called Creative Mythology. One of Campbell's books, he wrote many books, he was quite prolific, but one of his series of books is called The Masks of God, and it consists of four parts. And the fourth part is called Creative Mythology. The others are, I think, Primitive Mythology, Oriental Mythology. I can't remember the third one. So in Creative Mythology...
Well, I think it's Occidental Mythology.
Occidental
Western.
Mythology, yeah. Of course.
We can't forget that one.
Can't forget that one.
Yeah.
But you know that series then. It's a blockbuster, isn't
yeah.
it? Yeah. So anyway, in Creative Mythology, he deals extensively with two great medieval narratives, Tristan by Gottfried von Strasbourg and Parsifal, which exists in numerous versions. Now, he makes a statement in that book to this effect. This is almost an exact quote. Parsifal is the paramount secular myth of the Western world. Now, what that means is that it is the paramount and supreme guiding story of the Western world and of all Western cultures, whether they be Germanic, French, Hispanic, whatever. It contains the master narrative, the story of Parzival, according to Joseph Campbell. And I totally agree. And I hope I intend by the end of this conversation to make it clear exactly why that is so. And I'd also like to show, by introducing the Kalika War Party, that myth is a myth to be lived. It's not merely a myth to sit back and read for entertainment or some edification that you might get, some insight about yourself you might learn from reading the myth. That can certainly happen. But the way that I teach mythology is by participation. So I speak of directive myths, myths that can direct your life and even direct the lives of whole nations and cultures. Now, sometimes a myth can direct people very badly, because there are, you know, toxic myths.
Yeah.
There are pathological myths. If you just take the simple view that a myth is a narrative produced by human imagination, I think that's a good basic definition. Well, it leaves open whether that narrative makes sense and is an enlightening and moral story, or whether it is destructive. I'll give you an example of a toxic pathological myth, the myth of the chosen people.
Yeah.
The myth of the Messiah, the myth of the apocalypse. Now, there's certainly no doubt that those myths have a huge impact in human history, globally, wouldn't you say?
Way too much, yeah.
Yeah, way too much. And yet we can recognize at the same time that the power of myths cannot be avoided. So we can't just say, those are terrible myths, those are lies, those are pathological lies that have been somehow hatched out of human imagination, and let's get rid of them and move on from here. Sorry, folks. It just can't be done that way. Yeah. There has to be a countermanding narrative that's strong enough to supplant and overcome and defeat the pathological myth. And this is what I see in the myth of Parzival. This is what Joseph Campbell also saw. Now, you mentioned that Parzival was a warrior, and that's true. He was a knight of the round table. But at the same time, he was a mystic, because the main theme of Parzival's story is the quest for the Holy Grail. Isn't that true?
Yeah.
And so what you find in the myth of Parzival is a combination of two extremely powerful elements. One of them is the quest for the Holy Grail, whatever that is, a mystic quest, which might be considered the supreme mystical quest. I certainly consider it to be the supreme mystical quest on this planet, is the quest for the Holy Grail. But combine that with a warrior path. So it's a warrior and a mystic, you see, in the character of Parzival. Now, how did I come to the Kalika War Party? Well, I came by living the story of Parzival, by living that myth and letting it direct my life, which is what you can do with myths that you choose, if you choose them wisely, if you have the discernment to choose myths that are creative and positive and moral. And there are some, there are many, and many of them are the creations of the white races, I might add. Mm. Many of the most inspiring directive myths on this planet are the creations of the white Aryan races. That's just a fact. So, I guess I started talking about the Kalika War Party, two or three years ago, when I was doing some interviews on a certain platform that no longer exists. And at the time, I didn't really have the formation of it and the structure of it that is to be revealed this evening. It's just as if, in the course of my life, because I loved and lived this myth so deeply, or Parzival, that a germ was formed in me, you know? The germ of the Kalika War Party was born in me, in this course of living this myth. And so I've, you know, in many ways, pursued the same things that Parzival pursued, the quest for the Holy Grail in particular. And without going into a digression, I'd just like to say, if I might, and I'm happy and proud to be able to tell people on Red Ice Radio, in case anyone is curious, what the Holy Grail actually is.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I heard someone talking the other day, I don't want to go into a regression, but I'll say this in less than a minute, who claimed that the Holy Grail, the quest for the Holy Grail, is just a path or practice leading to self-knowledge. It's a way to know yourself. Have you ever heard a line like that?
Plenty of times. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Well, that's absolute and total crap. And anyone who says anything like that reveals that they don't have the faintest idea what the Holy Grail is. The Holy Grail is one thing and one thing only. This can only be said by someone who has attained the Grail. It is the organic light. And to attain the Grail is to encounter that light. Now, what is the organic light? Well, it is the light that was witnessed in the ancient mysteries of which no one ever spoke. There was a vow of silence, not secrecy. A vow of silence applied to protect the sanctity of this light. It is the light of the earth itself. It is the light of the naked body of the goddess Sophia, who is in material immanence in the earth. It's sort of like the body of a woman. When you see her with clothes on, that's when you see the planet you're looking at right now. You see the trees, the rivers, the mountains, the clouds, the plants. That is the clothing of the Aeon Sophia, of her body. When you see her naked, you see the organic light. It is a singular and unmistakable experience, and it is the same for everyone. So the organic light that is in the story of Parzival is a story about a young man who found his way to the encounter with the organic light. He was a warrior of the Arthurian knights, and the whole story is a fantastically beautiful adventure, a romance with a very complex plot. An amazing plot. But there's a remarkable factor in the Grail story that I would like to focus on, because it is the secret to the Kalika War Party, you could say. Or you could also say maybe, well, it's the qualification for entry.
Right.
There is something called the Grail question. Scholars discuss this thing called the Grail question when they analyze the works of Wolfram von Eschenbach, who wrote Parzival, the best version, the pagan version. Have you ever heard this term, the Grail question?
No, actually I haven't.
Well, it's extremely important, not only because it's a key to the whole Parzival adventure and how it turns out, but even more so, really, Henrik, because it's a key to the humanity of every single person. You could say that unless you can ask the Grail question, you haven't really realized what it is to be human.
Yeah.
And so Parzival asks the Grail question in the story. And his failure to ask the question the first time determines a lot of the events that happen in the story. Then he comes around to a second opportunity. He's at the castle of the Grail, and all of the family of the Grail, they're called the Company of the Grail. These are the people who live in the company of the organic light. They are, in fact, the diaspora of the great initiates of the pagan mysteries. And among these people is the one called Anfortas, the wounded Grail king. And the trick to the plot of Parsifal is that in order to prove that he is worthy to hold the attainment of the Grail, he must ask the Grail king a question. But no one can tell him what that question is. No one can prompt him or coach him. It must come out of his innermost soul. And so what is the Grail question? It's the question that every single human being must ask in order to fully become a human being. In the text of Wolfram von Eschenbach, the Grail question is translated in just three simple words. What ails thee? Parsifal is kneeling, the young knight, he's very young, is kneeling before the old, old knight, the wounded fisher king. And he's suffering from a deep wound that he received in a battle. He was pierced by a lance. And this wound will not heal. Yet he cannot die from this wound. Neither can he be cured. This is the plight of patriarchy. This is the plight of the wounded Grail king. And part of Parsifal's mystical mission is to ask the king this question. And it's usually translated as, what ails thee? So he's asking the old wounded knight, well, what hurts you? I've thought a lot about the Grail question, and I could say something really wonderful happened when I realized that I could put words to the Grail question that had never been put before. What I mean is that I could put it in a language, in a phrase, and when I put the Grail question in that phrase, suddenly the Kalika War Party was born. Mm. Are you following me here?
Sure, go ahead, John.
Good. So I thought, well, wait a minute. Parsifal was a young knight. He fought many battles with lance, with sword, hand to hand. Amphortas, it's from the old Greek amphematas, meaning wounded or ailing. Amphortas was a very old knight, sustaining a terrible wound, yet he could not die. He was in terrific agony. Now, what would the young knight, these are two men of the warrior class. They know what it is to fight. They know what it is to be wounded. What would the young knight kneeling before the old knight actually ask him when he saw the wound? Well, I thought, after many, many years of reflection, that what he would actually ask would be, well, who did that to you?
Right, yeah.
Isn't that what one knight would ask another knight? Mm-hmm. How did you get the wound? Who did that to you? You see? Yeah. That is the Grail question. And so, today, the day I announce the Kalika War Party, I ask everyone who's listening to line up with me, shoulder to shoulder with you. We're all standing in a line, shoulder to shoulder as equals. And we're looking at humanity. We're looking at the wounded species of humanity. And we all ask it the same question. Well, humanity, who did that to you? That question is a question about suffering. Because the fact is, on this planet, a lot of people are suffering right now as I'm speaking these words. Isn't that correct?
That is correct.
But you and I, fortunately, are not suffering right now, are we?
Yeah, no, I know what you're getting at. Not physically, but we suffer in different ways, right?
Right, but we don't have bombs railing down on our heads.
No, no, of course not, no.
We're not in the situation that many, many people in this world are in, where they can't feed themselves, where they're starving, where they don't have water to drink, where they're being subjected to one form or attack of another, you know? So it's probably the case with people who are listening to this interview. Ask yourselves right now, those of you who are hearing my words, are you suffering? Well, you may be suffering from some personal matter, like the death of a family member or something like that. But you're not suffering in the way that the wounded Grail King was suffering. Yet many, many people on this planet are suffering in that way. And if you want to be human, if you want to step up to the plate and be a warrior on this planet, then you have to ask, well, who is doing that? Who is causing this suffering? Now, and what can you do about it?
Right.
If you want to do something about it, you know, if you want to, you could live your whole life, some of the people listening now, and I myself, and you as well, Henrik, we could live our whole lives and never come under a really direct lethal attack from the enemies of life.
Yeah.
It's possible.
Oh, absolutely. I think it's too much of that. I think it's too much of that kind of isolation of being just stuck in the creature comforts and never really experiencing that part of life, you know?
Well, you know, it's a question of empathy, wouldn't you say?
Sure.
It's like, I have my creature comforts. I'm not under direct attack. I'm not hiding in a hole in the ground and fleeing white frost, phosphorus and chemical weapons and jet fighters. But some people are right now, right as I speak, okay? Yep. And what am I to do? Well, sit here and think, well, because it doesn't touch me and I'm not there with them, then I can't do anything about it and I'm not going to think about it. Anyone who does that definitely excludes themselves from the Kalika War Party.
Right.
Because one of the qualifications of this party is that you have to care about the suffering of humanity, even if it doesn't reach you in a gruesome manner.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay? So, the question, the Grail question is, who did that to you? And when I got the question in that way, something fell into place in my mind that I swear had not fallen into place in my whole life. I've thought a lot about suffering and the nature of suffering. I first began to consider or examine or investigate the nature of suffering through Buddhism when I was about 19, and I was wandering around India and out there in the Far East, and I came across the teachings of Buddhism, and I came across what is called the Four Noble Truths. This is one of the basic teachings of the historical Buddha. You probably have heard of it. Many people have. According to the Four Noble Truths, all existence is suffering. Sarvam dukkham. Mm. Dukkham, dukkha, means suffering in Sanskrit. Sarvam dukkham, that's the first noble truth. Everything is suffering. This is what Buddhism teaches. So I started out, you know, chewing on that morsel when I was quite young. And I was not really satisfied with what Buddhism has to say about suffering. And I can tell you right now, with no hesitation whatsoever, that Buddhism is an absolute and total failure when it comes to the question of suffering. It has no answer. Its approach is ignorant and impotent. And I'll tell you why. Because Buddhism does not distinguish suffering of the two kinds. It does not, when the Buddhists say savam dukkham, all is suffering, they don't distinguish that there are two kinds of suffering that human beings can endure. One is just what happens in the natural course of life. You may lose a person precious to you. An animal may die, you suffer. You may have an accident and break your leg. We can suffer in life from a variety of things that befall us just in the course of life.
Yeah.
But there's another kind of suffering, isn't there?
Yeah, an imposed one, right?
A deliberately imposed suffering. So, for instance, the example that I have used before is, if you have a beautiful young daughter, let's say if I have a beautiful young daughter and I don't have any children, but suppose I had a beautiful young 12-year-old daughter and she drowned in a swimming accident, I would really suffer badly.
Yep.
Those things happen in life. But take this scenario. If my 12-year-old daughter was abducted by a murderous pedophile, molested, and then killed, well, I would suffer from that too. But it wouldn't be the same kind of suffering.
Yep.
And the Kalika War Party is about the second kind of suffering and what to do about it.
Yeah.
You can't do anything about the first kind, can you?
That's nature. It's part of life and existence.
It's part of existence, and in some ways it can enrich you.
Absolutely.
It can deepen your humanity.
Yeah, definitely. I think so. I think that's a key to a lot of things, you know.
And so in facing the question of suffering, which is where it all starts with the Kalika War Party, stand before the question of suffering and be a real human being. Face it. Don't turn away. In standing in front of that question, we can say, okay, I accept that kind of suffering that comes in the course of life, and I wish that it would deepen my humanity, give me compassion, teach me things, make me more humble, make me more stronger, and whatever doesn't kill me does make me more stronger.
Mm.
That's a good creed to live by.
Yeah.
Then we turn our glance to the other kind of suffering. The mass amount of suffering on this world today, on this planet, is suffering that is deliberately inflicted by some human animals on other human animals. And the question that burns in my mind now is, what am I going to do about that kind of suffering? So that's kind of the process of thought I went through. Just taking you through it sort of like I went through.
Yeah,
you see?
Yeah, great.
Those are the considerations that I made. And finally, I was making these considerations like all my life, really. I didn't know I was. I was making them sort of subconsciously. Then they began to become more and more conscious. Then they began to be urgently, blazingly conscious.
Mm.
And then it broke through for me. And the minute it broke through was in March of this year when I completed the Gaian Navigation Experiment. And in the last briefing of that 3-year event, I said, I finally come to realize what the world needs. That is a solution to all the problems on this planet. It needs a warrior class.
Yeah.
A warrior class who will stand in defense of humanity, in defense of life, in defense of the planet, of all sentient beings, and who will counterattack those who deliberately harm others.
Yeah.
Now, why do I say this is the sole solution? I say that because it is a solution that covers all other solutions. No matter what else you may be doing, and I'm sure many people listening to these words are doing their absolute human best to deal with what's wrong on this planet. And I send love and courage to everyone who takes on that mission to make a better world, to clean up society, and to fight in one way or another for life and beauty and freedom. I'm right there alongside you, but I must add a particular insight that no matter how good you are at changing the world for the better, if those who don't want the world to change can't be eliminated, then you're not going to make it. And in my mind, elimination is the operative term.
Yeah.
I mean, we would all love to change the world, wouldn't we, Henrik, to go out and dance in the streets tomorrow and change it. Sometimes it seems like it's right at your fingertips. It would be so easy because we know that human nature is innocent and kind, basically, because that's the way we are. And if we could just change the world by a stroke of magic, we would do it.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, of course.
But there are people who don't want the world to be changed.
Exactly. Yeah.
And those are the same people, the psychopaths, the intra-species predators, and the enemies of life, I call them. Those are the same people who will not allow change to happen, change for the better. And those people have to be eliminated in any possible way, including magic. Now, just to get things aimed in the right direction here, let me point out something. The Kalika War Party is a blueprint for a warrior class. What is a warrior class? It means a gathering of people from any nation, any culture, any ethnic group, any place on the planet. A gathering of those people to unite in one single goal, and that is to eliminate psychopaths and the enemies of life from this planet, to terminate them. So it is a radical attack program.
Yeah.
And part of the strategy of the party is to use magic. Now, it's often been said that they use magic against us, right?
Sure, yeah.
How many people claim that? How many hundreds of times have you heard people claim that? Oh, they're using magic. The Illuminati are using satanic magic on us, right? Satanic magic / mind control / psychotronic weapons, you name it, right? I mean, how many people have you interviewed who've said this?
Well, a lot of them, you know, occult methods and subversive, you know, esoteric practices, etc. Yeah, for sure.
That's right. Well, two can play at that game, pal. And if they can attack us with occult and esoteric methods, I certainly know how to attack them in return. And this is what the Kalika War Party is dedicated to doing. Now, on that note, I just want to make one thing really, really clear. This is a really important point in this conversation. The warriors of the Kalika War Party that I'm proposing, that I'm inviting, are also shamans. So there is a blend of the shaman and the warrior together. in the members of the war party. Shamanism has a lot to do with the way the party operates, okay? And one thing that's caused me a considerable amount of distress over many years now is that the revival of shamanism that we see in many, many instances, you know, ayahuasca shamanism or whatever, you know, shamanism is a big trend, right? It's a big fad.
Oh, yeah.
Right? It's huge, yeah. Right? Yeah. The revival of shamanism has been proceeding with one very serious omission. If you go and you look at the traditional shamanic societies anywhere you want, whether it be in Siberia, in the depths of the Peruvian jungles, whether it be in Hawaii among the kahunas, whether it be in the warrior class of the Nordic and Teutonic peoples, any shamanic culture you look at, you will see that the figure of the shaman is recognized as someone who can heal and kill.
Yep.
And they've left out the killing part. The revival of shamanism does not consider that aspect, that responsibility, which a shaman has. Every true shaman has not only the capacity to heal, but also the ability to kill. The same tools can be used. For instance, there's a very powerful plant called tohe in Peru. It's called datura, jimson weed, devil's weed. Carlos Castaneda used it. It's one of the top five psychotropic plants. It's very dangerous. Grows around here all over the place. Well, you can heal with datura. You can go into a deep trance if you don't put yourself in a coma and investigate other worlds. You can do all kinds of supernatural adventures, and you can also kill people with it. So the mission of shamanism is given in the nature of the plants, of the sacred plants that shamans use. And any of these sacred plants, you name them, can equally be used to heal or to harm. So that's a really important point that I'd like to register and get across to people who are listening to our conversation here tonight.
Yeah, yeah. Because, and it's an important point. I think I've said that for a while now, that we're lacking this this warrior class. You know, we're lacking someone, a lot of people who are ready to take that stand and actually to do something. And the revival of some of these traditions have come in and kind of debilitated, emasculated version of it. And it's not, as you say, it's not complete, because sometimes in order to heal, you will need to be in a position where you can, you know, cut out the rot, right? You need to be able to take care of business to make sure things heal. I'm completely on that page with you.
Yeah. You need to be able to lance the wound and get the pus out, you know?
Yeah.
And there is such a thing on this planet as human pus and human vermin. You know, a maggot is a more noble creature than some of the people that are running banks and countries on the planet Earth. A maggot.
But they've managed to get us to think and believe that this is not the case. Everyone has good in them. It's our job to, you know, retrain these people, put them in the right environment, blah, blah, blah. All these things we're hearing over and over again. How long is that going to continue, you know?
Well, the perpetrators and the psychopaths hope it goes on forever.
Exactly.
Because it absolutely favors their program.
It protects them, you know? Yeah.
It absolutely protects them. You know, I pointed out in Not in His Image that the gospel of Jesus, so-called, the gospel attributed to Jesus, was probably written by the enemies of humanity.
Right, yeah.
Because Jesus taught, well, resist not evil and love your enemy.
Yeah.
Well, who would write that rule if it wasn't the enemy?
I agree.
I dare anybody. You can write me at jll@metahistory.org. I dare anybody on the planet to give me an example from history or from their own personal life in which resisting not evil and loving the enemy led to a good outcome.
Yeah, tell that to the Teutons, or you know, to the Rugi, or to any of these people that were annihilated by the Roman Empire. You know,
that's right, that's right. It's so manifestly false on the face of it. It's such a con. Now, we're not going to talk now this evening about how they've conned us, because there is a huge con game going on. Back in the 60s, we used to call it mindfuck. I love that word. People don't use it so much anymore.
It's a good word. Yeah,
but, you know, yeah. It says a lot, you know. It's not a fuck that you want to have, however. You know, it's not a fuck that you crave. It's a fuck that you don't want to have.
That's right. Yeah.
Yeah. So mind control is obviously a huge part of social evil. And so part of the attack upon humanity, let's talk for a minute about the attack upon humanity, because that would be a good way to lead into the actual structure and strategies of the party.
Okay? Yeah. I mean, we did, and just to clarify, obviously we talked about some of this last time too, but it needs to, I think you're right, it needs to be put in proper context so people understand that there's a reason behind this. There's a reason why this will have to be implemented, because otherwise, you know, What are the options? What are the other alternatives here? I don't think there are many, if any, you know?
Well, that's for people to decide once they hear what the party is and what its premises are. I'll read from the manifesto here in a minute. But just let me say, going into it, that the mind control and control of the narrative, well, that's a subject that you've discussed over and over again with many of your interviews, isn't it?
Sure, yeah.
Control of the narrative. Yeah. Mind control and control of the narrative are forms of psychological warfare. So, the human race, the human species, is not only under attack, actual attack, by heavy weapons and by shortwave, microwave weaponry and chemistry in the food and in the air. I mean, how many ways are they attacking us? You know, make an inventory. How many ways is the human species being attacked so that it can't simply get along with living and thriving and being creative and getting to know each other and getting along?
Yeah.
You know, how many ways?
Yeah.
So there are the brutal ways, using weapons, as is now being done in Syria, now being done in Ukraine, the United States, the USSA, the United Soviet States of America,
yep,
right, being mostly the imperial military force, right,
yep,
that is inflicting gruesome, murderous mayhem upon the planet, right? But in addition to that, there's a storyline. And so you're also being attacked simultaneously in your mind. You're being attacked by the lying narrative. And it's my view that the enemies of life really have the upper hand. And they've had it for a while, since about 1850, as far as I can tell. That's when the Jews were emancipated in Europe, by the way.
Yeah. Yeah.
So the narrative is killing us, and everything else they're doing to the food, to the air, is killing us. We've all heard this 1,000 times. And the plain and simple gruesome point I'm making is that it can't be stopped unless they are stopped, unless the executives and the executors and managers of social evil are stopped. It won't be stopped. Period. So I don't care what plan people have. People may have very, very good plans to change society and make it better, to change the banking system. Well, that's great, but you're not going to be allowed to change the banking system. So I don't care how good your plan is, it won't work. So as I said in the, let me see if I can find it here, in the manifesto of the party, I said that, can there be a single solution to the diverse and overwhelming problems in the world today? Well, obviously, there are countless particular solutions specific to each situation, but there is also one overarching solution that ensures the success of all the others, and that is the definition and deployment of a warrior class. So this is in the manifesto of the party. Yeah. And in the next paragraph, it explains very simply, well, why is that so? It's so because success in creating a better world depends on eliminating those who will not allow true and positive change to happen. They prevent it from taking its natural course. So if you and I want to do something, if we say, let's just take a silly example. If we go with a group of friends out to the park and we decide that we're going to play Frisbee like the hippies did, you know, in Sunset Park in San Francisco back in the good old days, and we're going to play Frisbee with our dogs in the park, oh, isn't that wonderful? But if there's a few people out there in the park who don't want us to play and who interfere physically or put up barriers or do the kinds of things they do to interfere with the free will of others, then we're not going to be able to have our party. We're not going to be able to change. So when I say there must be one overarching solution, that's what the warrior class is. Mm. And anyone can join it in any situation, in any country. It's absolutely a planetary movement.
So it's an understanding here that people have to come to, that this is something that could go on and on forever, well, until we are at such a state that life as we know it is actually terminated and ended. But the bottom line here is that we're taking an indefinite amount of crap and nothing is really changing on an effective level to be able to break ourselves free from the class of people you've been talking about.
Yes, lacking a decisive, planned, strategic, integral counterattack, we don't have a chance.
Yeah.
At least that's my humble opinion.
I agree. I've come to that conclusion as well, that something has to be done about it, because it's just it's just getting worse and worse and worse. And there has to be that kind of response to it. And I think people have to look at it historically as well, that's part of human nature. It's been part of our past of not only reacting to these things, but responding to them, of being in a position where we actually try to counteract what's happening to us. And I've been so frustrated with the fact that we've been so debilitated. We've been so domesticated also on top of things, that we're almost at a point where we're incapable of dealing with some of these things, which is tremendously dangerous for all of mankind.
It's very dangerous, Henry. Very dangerous. Domestication and pacification of the human animal has been going on under patriarchy for centuries. And religion has been largely a tool of this pacification, particularly the Christian religion.
Yeah.
Not Judaic religion so much, and certainly not Islam, which is another subject. But the religion of Christianity has taught, well, I just said, who would write the formula? Love your enemy and resist not evil. I say your enemy wrote that formula and made you adopt it out of shame and guilt. And, the warrior spirit has been, as far as I can tell, beaten out of the soul of most people walking around on this planet.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And there is one chance to rally. It's what Don Juan called the sorcerer's rally. When the sorcerer rallies at the final moment of an experiment, of a venture into the Nahual, or of a confrontation with an enemy, be it natural or supernatural, the sorcerer has to rally. Does it mean to rally? It means two things, which again were specifically prefigured in Castaneda's work. The first thing is that you bring the totality of yourself to the challenge.
And why is that important?
Because you can't do it half-heartedly, or you can't do it just on, among other things. It has to be the total focus of your existence. You bring the totality of yourself to it.
It has to be for real, right? Otherwise, it's something that we look at from a distance. I mean, again, that's why it's important with recognizing the reality of the threat, because otherwise, if we don't take this seriously, how are we going to be able to fight seriously?
That's right. And the second thing, the second element is that you know that what's worth living for is worth dying for. And you're going to die anyway.
There's a Norse proverb that says, if you don't live for something, you'll die for nothing.
That's right. That's right. So you have to have something to die for, and you have to bring the totality of yourself to this challenge today. And this challenge, defined in the manifesto of the party, is to take down the psychopaths and the enemies of life, and to use varied means, including magic. So there is instruction within the Kalika War Party of how to use magic in various ways, and one of those ways is to use magic to kill. This is called the Kalika Lethal Strike. Now, I'm sure there's some people who would say, well, killing isn't going to get you anywhere. Well, have you tried it? You know, has anybody tried it yet?
Right.
Depends on who you kill, you know. I mean, this line has been said by Clint Eastwood many times before. You know? Yeah. Hey, it looks like there's going to be some killing taking place in this town. Yeah, well, it depends on who you kill, you know, because they're killing you. They're killing you. You're not just killing you. They're killing generations of people.
Exactly, yeah.
You know, what did Madeleine Albright, you remember that famous one? Madeleine Albright. Well, was she Secretary of State? Famous interview. You can see it on the internet. Some woman says to her, well, you know, we've done a lot of damage in Iraq here, you know, since the fall of Saddam Hussein, and something like, you know, there's 500,000 children have died. Do you think it was worth it? Oh, yeah. Well, worth it to who, Madeline?
Yeah.
Worth it to whom, to use the correct grammar? You see, so they don't think anything of killing 500,000. I'll put it this way. If Madeleine Albright doesn't think anything of killing 500,000 children, then why should I think anything of killing Madeleine Albright?
Yeah. You're right.
Let's wake up and face it, because that is the test of this divine experiment. It is the test of conscience.
And it's not an unfounded attack at this point. It's based in self-defense.
You can call it self-defense. Yeah, it's in defense, but it's not just in defense of your personal self. Now, you know, if I go out, for instance, you know, to a bar one night, this happened to me once actually, and some drunk crazy person like attacks me physically, you know, out in the street, then I have to defend myself, right? Mm-hmm. That's self-defense. Yeah. But we're talking about defending, you know, people you don't even know, defending people who can't fight for themselves, defending the earth, defending the birds, the bees, the snakes, the whales, defending all life against the enemies of life. That is the fucking bottom line.
Yeah.
And the time has come to do something. And the time has come to strike back. And the Kalika War Party is a strike force organized in a very particular and precise manner to deliver the maximum counterattack against those who are ruining life on this planet.
Yep.
And it's not just taking out or eliminating specific agents of the agenda of social evil. That's just part of it. It's taking out the whole fracking system. It's about how to take down the whole system, to attack the systems, like advertising is part of the system, like law is part of the system, like the lies of the media, the entertainment industry, the biochemical industries. All of these are parts of the system of social evil. And there is a place in the 17 bands of the party for a particular strike force to act against each of these social evils. So it's a very precisely organized strategic blueprint for action.
Yeah.
Because I don't think it can be done any other way, Henrik.
Yeah, you know,
this is not, we need to unite here. We need to unite, not even necessarily to unite like into a mob. I don't mean that at all. The Kalika War Party structure is set up in such a way that if you place yourself in one of the bands of the party, and we'll look at them in a moment, if you'd like.
Sure, of course.
Then you know what band you're in, and you know what your target is. You know what your assignment is, because each of the bands has very particular assignments. What's the logic behind that? Well, I think it's fairly obvious. I mean, we're under such a massive attack that no single person can possibly counterattack everything, right? Mm-hmm.
Yeah. No, it's too much.
For instance, suppose one of the war parties, and this would be one of the bands, and this would be band 12. One of the assignments of band 12 is to take down the network of institutionalized pedophilia and everybody in it. How's that for an assignment?
Yeah.
Now, if you place yourself in that band, and as I'll explain, belonging to the Kalika War Party is a volunteer action. It's a self-selection into the party. If you place yourself in that band, you're going to have to bring the totality of yourself to that mission, and you're going to have to concentrate on it. And then you can't go out and fight Monsanto, can you?
Right.
You know, one of the reasons why people... I really believe, but I don't want to make, don't take this as an excuse. I'm not making excuses, but I know, Henrik, that one of the reasons why people are not doing anything is because they're paralyzed, because they're getting hit by from so many sides at once that you don't know where to turn.
Oh, absolutely. They're overwhelmed. This is a strategy in itself. There's just so many problems. Where do you even begin, right? And
yeah, where do you fight back? Yeah. You know, there are so many fronts. There are so many things coming at you every day, you know?
Yeah. You have to pick your battles, right?
And you have to pick your fight.
Yeah.
You have to pick your fight. So there is great strength in the party. Even if the members of the party do not mass together as a visible army, and I don't see this being the case, but there's great strength in the party because the Thunderbird formation of the ranks allows each person to place themselves in a band and to take a particular mission. Now, if I place myself in band 12 and I take the mission of bringing down institutionalized pedophilia, and I'm living in Detroit, Michigan, then I know that even though I may be alone, or I might only have one other Kalika warrior with me physically, that Kalika warriors all over the world are undertaking the same mission because they're in the same band.
Yep.
That's the power of the party. It is a planetary event, truly planetary event. So you could be in, you could have four members of band 12 in Johannesburg, South Africa, San Francisco, Tokyo, and Paris. And they might never meet each other physically, but they would know that they are in the same band and that the action of an individual in the band gathers all the force of the band behind it. And people need this. because no single individual is strong enough to go out and take on what's coming at us.
Yeah, this is the time we need, at whatever level you do that on, but we need, you know, we've been so individualized, atomized, and again, specifically
right.
in the West, at least, we've lost. There is a good upside to a kind of a collectivism, if you want to call it, or cooperation is a better term, of course. But still, we've been, we need that back into the picture. We need to help each other out, band together, create a brotherhood and a sisterhood.
That's what the warrior class is, and it's a planetary warrior class. I emphasize, this has never existed before. As it says in the manifesto, warrior classes have existed in various societies through time. You know, the Arthurian knights are central to the European, white European tradition of heroism, aren't they?
Yeah.
But then there were the samurai, they were a warrior class. The jaguar and the eagle cults of the Aztecs were a warrior class. The Shaolin knights in China were a warrior class, you see? But they have been local. This is a non-local, planet-wide warrior class. And it is organized according to these ranks and bands in the Thunderbird formation in a way that is unlike anything that has ever existed.
Okay, well, you need to tell us a bit more about that then so people know what you're talking about there. And, of course, the symbol that you've chosen as well.
Sure. Well, I'm looking at it right now. You will, of course, provide the link to KalikaWarParty.org. And when you come to that page, you will see the Thunderbird formation. And beneath the Thunderbird, you will see the golden Thunderbird against black with 17 dots. And beneath the Thunderbird, it says, this site presents the morality and method for eliminating psychopaths and enemies of life from the world. So that's kind of like the mission statement. And then if you click on various things, you get the manifesto. But if you go to the Thunderbird and scroll down, you'll see there is the Thunderbird formation. Now, why a Thunderbird? Okay. Let's just take a step back here for a moment. I don't know if anybody out there hearing this interview has ever heard of planetary tantra. But planetary tantra is a visionary teaching and a visionary method that came to be defined in the year 2008. Okay? And planetary tantra consists of various components. It is a form of shamanism. It is indeed can be called Gayan Tantra, Gayan sorcery. It can be called Gayan shamanism, echo sorcery. It can be called by various names. And planetary tantra has at its core one simple and fundamental premise. And that is the shamanism of today and of the future on this planet is unlike any other shamanism. Because it is a shamanism based on power sharing with the planet. So if you are a practitioner of planetary tantra, if you want to go learn about it, there's a lot about it on the internet. If you are a practitioner like me, then you know that as a shaman, you perform your rituals, whatever they may be, by drawing upon the power of the earth itself. Interactive magic with Gaia is the subtitle of planetary tantra. This form of shamanism is a power-sharing arrangement. Each human animal shares his or her power with the source, the planetary animal mother, the light, the earth itself. This is the absolute hallmark of planetary tantra. Well, now you can transfer that same principle to the Kalika War Party. Remember, that this is a party of warrior shamans. So the warriors in the party also draw their power from the earth. For instance, specific example, the Kalika Lethal Strike. Now, this is an actual magic ritual intended to kill someone at a distance. No shaman on this planet can perform that strike correctly or effectively if they do not combine their power with the power of the earth. This is the technique of planetary tantra, and it's also the technique of the war party. So, a thunderbird is the symbol of the warrior power of the earth itself. It is the symbol of our mother. It is the symbol of the Aeon Sophia. And she brings us her rage and her power to kill. And believe me, do you think the earth has power to kill?
Oh, yeah.
Well, think about it.
Of course it does. Yeah.
Just think about it a little bit. She brings to our use an application, the supernatural power of her own body. And you can picture that power as a thunderbird, a raptor, a dangerous, very dangerous looking bird, if you look at the icon of the Kalika War Party. Now, why a thunderbird again? Well, thunder is a theme in planetary tantra. As a matter of fact, the word thunder in English occurs in the Nag Hammadi Library. Did you know that? In the title of one of the most magnificent and best preserved pieces of the Gnostic material.
Hmm. All right.
Thunder. Perfect mind.
Right.
Yeah. Thunder in Sanskrit is Vajra, which also means lightning, which also means crystal. So this theme of thunder, perfect mind, Vajra mind, diamond mind, thunderbolt, pervades planetary tantra. And those who have been in the practice now over the last, 6 years or so, would be able to testify to what I'm saying. I'm sure they would happily do so. The power of thunder, the connection with the electrical, violent electrical force of the earth is a connection to the planetary animal mother.
Like the electric activity of our synapses firing, like that clear, a kind of a sharp, clear, you know. A thought can be like that, right? It's right there.
Crystal clear, crystal clear firing of your synapses when the circuits of your brain have been cleansed of all the garbage and the programming. And when you are crystal clear as a human being, you are crystal clear that a human being is an animal. And it's an animal that is designed to kill. I said this before in Red Ice, didn't I, Henrik?
Yeah.
Yeah. I said this quite a while ago, that part of what makes us divine and important to the planetary animal mother is that she has designed us to kill. But we just have to know how to use that power to kill in the correct way, morally, playfully, to kill in a beautiful way. To kill with beauty. Think of beauty as a weapon. This is what you have to learn to be in the party. This is what you have to learn to grow up and be a responsible human animal and stand up to the enemies of life.
Because there's nothing wrong with that design, with that plan. It's something which is inherent in us. And I know people will debate that, but I think we have to look at it differently. I think there's never been a time when there has not been a warrior class, I think, as there is now. Sure, people talk about other, you know, ages or what have you, but in the conception we find ourselves in as of right now, the idea that you need to be in a position where you where you defend your the children in your village, your women, etc. That's been part of human life and human nature for many, many hundreds of thousands of years.
Of course it has. And you are absolutely right. And every single society that has been connected to the earth and that has revered nature and retained respect for the harmony in nature, every single community, every single culture that has learned what it is to be human by looking at the non-human world has realized that we are designed in this way. And they have never, ever rejected violence in the way that it is rejected today, which is false and phony rejection of violence that only keeps human beings in a state of impotence.
Yeah, and it also keeps us in a position where by not applying this in well-directed areas and strikes to be able to keep clean of those who are who cannot stick to peaceful interactions and who are not subversive, deconstructive in the manner that we see today in the world. By not applying that properly, we are causing far much more harm in the long term than what it would be to maybe in the short term deal with this problem and take care of business. So it's like we lack that understanding of realize that due to those choices, because it might be temporarily more comfortable, we're in that comfort zone where we refuse to look at these kinds of conflicts and type of situations. When we look away, it's going to be much more, the suffering is going to be much worse in the long run. That's what I believe anyway.
Oh, you are so right. You are so right. And I don't know about the rest of you out there, but the suffering is bad enough for me right now. I don't need it to go another day. And I have to tell you that I say that from the position of someone who isn't affected in the least by it.
Right.
You know, externally speaking, I'm not physically in danger. I'm not starving. I don't have a lack of water to drink. I don't live beside, a toxic landfill. And yet I can't stand it anymore. I can't stand knowing that it exists on the planet that I live on. I can't stand it anymore. I have to strike back.
And you also know, right, John? You know and you understand that it's not about sitting around and waiting until this is something that reaches your doorstep. At that point, it will be too late.
Absolutely not.
The human project.
I'm going to go out and meet it in whatever way I can.
Yeah.
And getting back to what you just said, it's so helpful to remember what you just said, that this really, the warrior class has already existed always in sane societies, sane communities, before civilization became the monstrosity it is today. That is absolutely true. And I would point out to you also that the leading line of the Kalika War Party, if I read it again, it says, eliminating social evil, and it says this site presents the morality and method for eliminating psychopaths, enemies of life, from the world. So you might well wonder, well, wait a minute, what is the morality behind what John's proposing here? Because many people would say, well, this is taking life, or even threatening to take life, or harming people, and all this kind of stuff
right.
that he seems to be promoting here. That's not moral. Well, depends on where you get your morals from, my friends. I can't go into a long discourse here on Gaian ethics, but I can give you a 3-minute introduction. How about that?
And let me just interject that too. Just think about this while we talk here about this, but how is it not moral to take that responsibility of ensuring to dealing with that evil we see in the world, that violence that we see expressed against so many human beings today, and the destruction of everything. It's been said before, but all it takes for evil to persevere in the world is for good men to do nothing, and that's what we're talking about here.
You nailed it. It's all turned inside out. we've been taught that what is immoral for good and decent people who do not want to harm others, we've been taught that what is immoral for us is actually the morality that we need to be good and decent people. It's been turned completely inside out.
Yeah.
That is the mind control. You see?
That's right.
And can you see what advantage that gives to those who do harm and who wish to do harm and who do nothing but harm and who make a lifestyle and a business out of it? Can you see what it leaves the way for them, doesn't
yeah.
it?
Yeah, they're running the world today. That's what's happened.
Yeah, you have to ask yourself, I mean, how many times have you and I and all the people who listen to Red Ice asked themselves, how is it possible that human society has reached the stage where it is today? It's no longer even necessary to hide the fact that criminals and psychopaths are in the positions of authority and the positions of management in society all around the world.
Yeah.
You know, you can't even, it's so obvious, it screams at you every day. And you have to ask, how is it possible? It's possible because we have abdicated the morality that is required to make sure that that doesn't happen.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
To see yourself as a real human being capable of taking responsibility for eliminating evil, let me make this syntax clear. You're taking responsibility for something that you didn't do, but you are taking responsibility for seeing that it stops being done, okay?
Yeah.
Is that clear?
Yeah.
That's the cutting edge of this morality. Well, when you see yourself as a human being who really can do that, then you see yourself as an animal among other animals. Because let me tell you, it's so obvious if you look at the difference between human animals and other animals. There is the prey-predator relationship all through the animal world, right?
Yeah.
But animals that prey on other animals, such as eagles, raptors, falcons, owls, have a very limited range of prey, don't they?
Sure, yeah.
An owl, for instance, is a predator in nature. A cheetah is a predator in nature. And these predators have an extremely limited range of prey. Now look at the human animal. Does it have a limited range of prey? Fuck no. The human animal preys on every other species on this planet, and it preys on itself.
Yeah.
Now, if you can't see that and admit that, you are not in the game. But if you can see that, there is something tremendously liberating coming your way. That is the simple realization that that's the way we are, so let's make the best of it.
Mm.
If we're divinely designed to excel in violence, like I said on a previous Red Ice interview, then let's make sure we know how to handle that violence. And whether it be physical violence, it doesn't always have to be, but it can. It can be what I call violent intent. Part of the magic used by the warriors in the party is the magic based on intention, violent intent. You can formulate a violent intent and you can ritualize it and then direct it toward the target. So some activities in the party are of that kind. Other activities of the party would, for instance, be similar to what you would call guerrilla warfare, or street warfare.
Right, yeah.
For instance, there is a band in the party that is band number 13. And they, one of their missions, because there are sometimes more than one mission to each band, but one of their missions is to attack advertising. Now, there are many ways you can attack advertising. And it's been done in the street, if you know what I mean.
Sure.
So, that's right. Now, take another example. Surveillance cameras. Suppose that one band, I won't say which one it is, because I don't really know, because I don't have all these assignments and everything written out in a cut and dried fashion, by the way. I have to make this point really clear.
Sure, yeah.
I have the general blueprint. But let's say that one of the bands determines that their members are dedicated to attacking closed circuit surveillance television cameras.
Yeah.
You see, that's a form of violence against the system. And I realize that I'm taking a risk saying this because the authorities can look at me and say, well, this character, John Lash, could be causing us some trouble here because he's encouraging people, you know, to go and vandalize CC surveillance cameras. Let me ask you, do you think they need encouragement?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Excuse me. You know?
Yeah.
No, they don't need encouragement. They're boiling over to do it.
Yeah.
They're boiling over to do it. And all they need is someone to give them permission. And I hereby give it. Okay?
Yeah.
It's my pleasure to do so.
I'm so surprised we haven't seen, and I do see it now and then too, though, by the way, but just, you know, come on, people, for Christ's sake, you know, campaigns of disruption against these modalities that are destroying your way of life. Let's see some of it, you know, come on.
Campaigns of destruction in every direction.
Yep.
You see people going out and tearing up GMO crops, okay?
Mm.
That's Kalika War Party violence. That's violence directed in defense of life and directed against the enemies of life. Now, taking out the CEO of Monsanto, that would be a nice day, you see.
Yeah.
These are the options, and these things can be done. And what am I doing? Am I coming up with some really bizarre idea that nobody ever thought of? And, oh, here's John Lash, and, oh, he's finally done it now. Oh, boy. He's come out, and he's, like, endorsing and promoting, you know, violence. Although I haven't named any names, have I? And am I really doing that? I'll tell you what I think I'm doing. I think I'm saying what's on everybody's mind already.
Yeah.
You know, Henrik, is a funny thing about the human animal. We are deeply social creatures, and we are deeply dependent upon each other. It's a beautiful thing when that dependency goes to mutual aid. It goes to celebration. It goes to love, to shared pleasure. It can go in so many directions. And as a result of this deeply social nature of the human animal, it's a funny thing about people, but sometimes they need another person to give them permission to do what they already want to do.
Yeah. Like, okay, there's not just me then. You know, they need that kind of, I don't know if it's based on security, what it is, but yeah, you're right. You need that kind of realization that it's more, and that's why it's so important even to talk about that, because in getting that out there, because people think, well, am I the only one that's thinking this, and everyone's just sitting around and waiting for someone else to do something, you know?
That's right. And that becomes a limbo, and that becomes a black hole, and that becomes another point of impotence and despair, which is greatly to the advantage of the enemies of life.
Yeah.
You know, I've thought a lot about what I'm saying to you now. You can bet on it. If those of you who are really hearing what I'm saying must know that, you know, I wanted to come out and say what I'm saying now in a lucid and sober manner and in a balanced and sane way. And I have to tell you that I'm not afraid to say this, and I'm not afraid to be viewed as someone who is endorsing violence, because all I'm doing is talking to what is already there.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. You know, violence is simmering over. It's like a pressure cooker that's about to explode.
Well, exactly. Well, you know what? I was thinking about that when you talked earlier, and I think it's about also managing or getting to a position where you actually can, control that, turn that into an art, mastering that. Otherwise, if not, I think we get the, then we get those kinds of explosive events of, I mean, there are examples we could take here, you know, Breivik in Norway or whatever, misdirected anger, right. Frustration, someone right. who blows something up where a lot of people are, you know, hurt, and it's, you know, that have nothing to do with the problems that, you know, he was talking about specifically and things like that, right? So it's a dangerous thing. And I think that we see people snap and you know, they break of sorts internally.
Of course they do.
Because it's not mastered and controlled, you know?
Of course. You know, one of the words that I use this word, violence, and it has to be used very carefully and very skillfully. You know, what does John Lash mean by violence? John Lash is endorsing violence, you know? What is this? Perhaps it would be more acceptable, although I don't give a damn if it's acceptable or not, but perhaps it would be more acceptable to the minds of some people to use the word rage, you know?
Yeah.
There is a boiling rage in the human species against what has been done by the enemies of life on this planet. But the problem is, and the enemies of life understand this very, very well, is that the rage, if it boils over mindlessly and without direction, will harm those that it's not supposed to harm.
Yeah.
You see?
Yeah.
And so the whole challenge of the party, one of the great challenges faced by the party, is what I call to achieve elucidated anger. Elucidated anger, and to aim your rage and aim your violent intent steadily and correctly toward the right targets. You know, let's not be naive here, folks. The psychopaths, for instance, in the United States, I'll just speak of my own country, which is a land that I deeply love. I consider myself to be a true American. But since the United Soviet States of America has come into existence, you hear all this news about Homeland Security acquiring all this hollow point ammunition and everything, right?
Yeah.
And it's quite clear that the authorities are manipulating the populace of the United States of America toward an armed confrontation, right?
Yeah.
It's clear. There is bound to be an armed confrontation. But the authorities want that. Why do they want it? Because in the revolutions that they have been able to foment so far, going back to the French Revolution as the first outstanding historical example in recent times, in all those revolutions, they have been able to hijack the violence. And they have been able to manage the violence. Look at what happened in the Russian Revolution.
Yeah.
It started out in 1905, the February Revolution, as a genuine armed uprising of the people, right?
Yeah.
And 12 years later, by 1917, with the October Revolution, it was completely hijacked by the Jewish Bolsheviks.
Yeah.
You see?
That's right.
Take a lesson from history. They don't mind violent upheavals among the people as long as they can manage them. The thing that the authorities fear the most on this planet is violence and rage coming from people who are sober and steady warriors who know how to aim it and know how to handle it. And it's time to learn those skills. And those Kalikas in the party learn those skills and teach them to each other.
Yeah, I think that's wise, you know, because we're so disattached, you know, to these kinds of things, and we, you know, grown men sit at home and they play, you know, Call of Duty and watch violent movies, but, you know, they've never, you know, punched someone or been punched in the face. It's like this disattached weirdness to these kinds of issues, which makes the whole situation so much more, you know, disturbing and perverse. I can't really find any other words for it. And we're so disattached in the same way that we, you know, a lot of us eat meat, but we've never even, you know, killed an animal or seen one killed that we are to eat. You know, that's what's
that's
wrong
right.
about it, you know?
You know, the Archons have a role in this as well. there is a supernatural element behind the attack upon humanity and the earth. I've talked about it a great deal, as you know, probably talked about it more than anybody else. And who knows, maybe even better than anybody else. But I addressed that question again in the manifesto under this section of the supernatural, where the manifesto says that there is a supernatural and extra human factor at play in the worldwide battle. And this is the alien force that intrudes upon the human mind, and it takes advantage of the evil done by humans to each other and makes that evil even worse. A really good example of the working of the archonic factor in this war is the massive, massive participation in these games. World of War, Warcraft, I don't even know the names of these games.
Yeah.
There are millions of people playing these games, right?
Yep. Oh, yeah.
Which are archontic games. That is to say, they're games of simulation. Remember that the Gnostics warned us that the archons have a tool among their various tools. They have one tool at which they are supremely skillful, and that is HAL, which means virtual reality or simulation. So, due to the archonic influence, which is like a spell cast over the human mind, millions and millions of men, and presumably women as well, spend untold hours in their lives playing these war games. This is insane. I have to say to those people, you are deplorable fools, and I fucking hate you. I hate you for playing those games. And you should be ashamed of yourself and ashamed to show your face in public if you play those games. I invite you to come into the Kalika War Party and play some real games.
Yeah.
Some real magic.
Yeah.
But you'll have to risk your life to do that. Whereas when you're playing World of Warcraft, sitting on your ass in the sofa in your cell and eating potato chips, you're not risking anything, are you?
No.
So this is the state it's got to. It can't, you know, you wonder if it can't get any worse, don't you? Well, I stopped wondering, Henrik, whether it's going to get any worse or not. It's bad enough for me. It's time to get this party started.
Yeah. So you said you didn't have all the bands, as you call them, kind of outlined or whatnot, but is there any more there that you want to just kind of tell for people? Yeah.
If you go to the KalikaWarParty.org page, which you will link, and across the top of the menu, you have Manifesto. Be sure to read that. Protocols. That's my neologism for protocols. Protocols is what you need to know to be cool in the party, because we all want to be cool with each other. There are certain rules, okay? They're not authoritarian rules. They're just guidelines for agreements. Those are the protocols. Read those. Then you come to Thunderbird. Now you click on Thunderbird, and it shows the Thunderbird formation. Going back to the Planetary Tantra for a moment, there is a central icon of Planetary Tantra. It's a mandala of great power. It represents the emergence of the turbulent force of the planetary animal mother into a standing field. This is called the Shakti Cluster. Shakti Cluster has been in existence on this planet since August of 2008. And now, if you look at the Shakti Cluster, and then you turn your eyes and look at the Thunderbird formation, you will see that the Thunderbird formation is the Shakti Cluster, but in a different configuration of points. Now, these points on the Thunderbird formation are arranged in five ranks. So the Kalika War Party consists of five ranks and 17 bands. And the names of the powerful infernal goddess warrior forces that drive those bands are given in the left-hand column. Now, some of those names may be alien or off-putting to you at first, because mostly they're Sanskrit names, but that doesn't matter. They're just names. They're just labels, and they are subject to change to more user-friendly labels as this party develops. But what you see is a blueprint for the strategic formations of the war party. Now, there are two ways you might consider this formation of dots on the Thunderbird. First of all, consider the old arts of war, say during Roman times. Back in those times, men on the battlefield would join in a particular formation, like a wedge or a large rectangle, right? Which is called a phalanx, right? They would join their shields together and they would make a formation so that they had more force than one single warrior standing alone, right?
Yep.
So when you see these points on the Kalika, of the Kalika bands on the Thunderbird, that is the same concept. It's a strategic formation of bands to give maximum force to each band and to the entirety. The second way you can look at the points on the Thunderbird formation is like the power points on the human body, like acupressure points, or the chakras, if you want to use that quaint old term. So the Thunderbird formation, which is a metamorphosis of the Shakti cluster, has 17 points, 17 bands arranged in five ranks. Now, as I explained, there's no hierarchy in this party. There's really not even any leader of this party. I just happen to be the one who's announcing the party. So in a certain sense, I appear to be the leader, nominally speaking or temporarily, because I am the one who gives it definition. But the organization of the party in the ranks is functional. It is not hierarchical. So there's no command and control structure in the Kalika War Party. Not at all. No. Each of the ranks has a different function regarding the total integrity and strength of the party. And I explain that in brief language in the text that goes with the Thunderbird formation. Finally, the last thing I might say before we sum up here, Henrik, is that there is right now, with the announcement of the party, there is no full description of what are the assignments of all these 17 bands. Okay? I have sketched out some of the assignments. For instance, like I said, band 12 under Tantra Mother, that would be Vajra Yogini in Tibetan terms, has the mission of destroying institutionalized pedophile networks and all of their members. That mission is specific to that one band, you see?
Yeah.
But there may be other missions that that band undertakes as well, which would be revealed in the course of time. Now, the band that I'm in, which is the band 1 of Mahakali, has the assignment to bring down all religions, not just Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, but also Buddhism. And I'm going for that big time in January. So stay tuned, folks. And to destroy, finally, all the structures of patriarchal male mind dominance. And this is an absolutely frontal attack on patriarchy. That's band 1. Now, there's a
Let me ask you about that. Do you want to clarify that a bit for people who think, oh, wait a minute, but that's the feminist stuff, right? And all that thing that comes along with that. That's another level of the propaganda, right? So do you want to explain that to people who might wonder about that?
Yeah, lately there's this MGTOW thing, men going their own way, and there's the men's right movement and everything. And it's all asinine and juvenile, in my opinion. And it's all trivial and it's like frivolous, really. And the people who are speaking for, it's just the downfall of feminism is creating a lot of dust and debris. And that's what these movements are. But one of the points in these movements is that the men's rights movement is saying, oh, well, there is no real patriarchy. It's just this boogeyman that feminists created. And the word patriarchy has now become put in question because feminists use it so loosely and they apply it so broadly. And that's all bullshit and ignorance and confusion. Patriarchy is very, very real and has been very real for millennia. And so don't get confused by the confusion of people who are getting caught in the collapse of feminism. And right. Feminism is going down. I think it's a really good thing. I expect that feminism will be in total ruins by 6 months from now. In fact, attacking feminism belongs to one of the assignments of one of the bands of the party. You see what I mean? But attacking it in the correct way. But as feminism goes down, it takes down a lot of women with it, and also takes down a lot of men. And so yeah. I don't think that these men and women are getting anywhere near the real solution for our species, which is the healing of the gender rift, something that I've talked about a lot. And particularly in the recent newsletters on Gaiaspora.org, you can see what I have to say about that subject.
Yeah, because, okay? I mean, I always saw that as, you know, feminism as part of the plot. And, of course, making it worse also for women due to the fact that men are ostracized, the rift gets worse. Case in point, just look at a country like Sweden where we have more or less state feminism implemented. There's nowhere they're so confused as Sweden when it comes to the gender roles and the eradication of them, child abuse, really, when they're starting to impose these on our young children, Swedish children. You know, it's horrible to see this.
Yeah, it's horrific. It's another aspect of the system. So Kalika warriors would not only attack the false rhetoric of feminism, they would attack and expose the false rhetoric of anti-feminism as well. Because a lot of the anti-feminism is really screwed up. These men in the MGTOW movement going their own way and leaving women behind. Well, excuse me, guys.
Yeah, that's horrible.
But I don't know exactly what you've got in mind there. What are you going to do, service each other and all turn into gay guys? Is that what you're going to do? Yeah. Are you all going to become celibate?
Yeah.
You know,
yeah,
it's an adolescent reaction against, you know, the very justifiable outrage at what feminism has done to men. But it's still an adolescent reaction that's not going to lead anywhere.
No, I mean, the answer is not to turn the back on women who's turned their back on men. It's quite the opposite. I think they on some level, be it that unconsciously, realize that that situation needs to heal and they need real men to come back into the picture. And acting like men, as women acting as women, you know,
that's right,
as well.
And acting together.
Yeah.
You know, acting together and supporting each other in our gender differences.
Exactly.
So yeah. The gender wars are in their terminal stage. And I think that when the dust and the debris clears, there is a good chance to return to really healthy and balanced gender relations between men and women. I talk about gender relations in the protocols of the party. They're very important because sexual energy is one of the fuels of the party. It's one of the warriors' assets, one of the warriors' most important tools is sexual energy. So sexual energy must be handled carefully and skillfully within the party, and that's an important point not to overlook. But finally, Henrik, just to give, you know, to round off my overview here,
sure.
If you read through under the Thunderbird formation, you will see that every one of the bands in the five ranks has been described briefly, you know? And for instance, rank four, Budevi, is assigned to fight against the enemies of the environment and to promote ecology, aesthetics, and material magic using the four elements and the four seasons. Also, this band, the Budevi band, number four, have the special mission of providing safe environments where warriors can gather and confer and be healed. So you see there, it's very, very specific. And it's so specific that it would be impossible at the outset to lay it all out in a cut and dried fashion. Do you understand? So I haven't done that. What I presented is a working blueprint for the structure of the party. And that blueprint becomes a force of flesh and blood as people find their places in these ranks. Now, one last thing I want to mention before we kind of wind up is that there is a FAQ page. And naturally, I expect people to be writing in to the Kalika War Party and saying, well, you know, how do I know what band I'm in and so forth? And this is an ongoing and developing dialogue that now begins. It's not something that I don't sit here at, you know, at some pinnacle of authority over the party and assign people to different bands. Everyone assigns themselves.
Right. Yeah.
And you will be directed to your assignment by the totality of yourself and by the direction of your deepest and purest rage.
Very good. So it's just emphasize that point again, as you mentioned, it's kind of it's decentralized. So when someone is thinking, well, you know, the warriors are out there ready to go. They're on standby. They want to turn in this direction that you've been talking about. You know, they say, well, where do I turn? Well, it's right there in terms of how to get involved. And it's not something that's going to be delegated or, you know, in that capacity. So it's something that could function even if, you know, one person falls off or 50 people falls off. It doesn't matter. It's a voluntary engagement that you go into. And in that capacity, it could be however many people you want, right? And et cetera. There can be a tremendous amount of people working on these issues that you've described.
That's right. It's a free-flowing, open system. I ask those of you who are attracted to what we've been talking about here for a couple of hours now, I ask those of you who are compelled and feel in your heart a real warrior's spirit to just contemplate the Thunderbird formation. Just look at it, print it out, and look at it, and then look at the different spots, the different bands, and then go and check out which of those bands are. For instance, band 10 under Kamala is assigned to Kala Tantra, the erotic arts, to sex education, to porn education. And their targets include the degenerate policies of sex education and gender equality, you see? So if someone were to take the particular mission of saying, someone in Sweden, I am going to take down the system that is forcing this ridiculous gender equality language upon our children and screwing up their ideas of their gender from the time that they're 3 years old, I'm going to take down that system and I'm going to go after the people who are running that system, then they would place themselves in band 10, you see?
Yep.
Self-selection. And I want to say, finally, as my last comment on the Thunderbird formation, you cannot imagine how powerful this is. You don't have enough imagination to see how powerful this is. You can see how powerful it is by getting into it and participating. And then that power will be yours. And when it's yours, you will know what it is. But I assure everyone who is listening to my words that the power of the rage of the planetary animal mother herself informs every band of this party. And when you fight as a Kalika warrior, you fight with her power behind you, in you, around you, and also with her protection.
All right, John, very good. Again, here then, KalikaWarParty.org, that's the website. And we're going to have that up on our websites, of course. Click through there if you feel, attracted to this, is something you want to, you know, read more about. Go over there and check it out and read more and see if you want to get involved in this. And as John explained as well, there's something to the more hands-on approach as well, if that's what something that you're attracted, you know, to in terms of what you can do. I think it's an idea that whose time has come, as they say, and the idea that we need to get involved. I mean, I welcome any kind of involvement at this stage, any kind of level, and, you know, concerted efforts of trying to do something about the situation we find ourselves in. And it's all good and well to talk about it. We need to do that. We need to continue to spread the word about these things, wake people up. But ultimately, if there's no, you know, action consequently due to it, it doesn't matter. We can sit around and talk about these problems all day long and nothing's going to happen. And our detractors, our enemies of life, as you said, John, they're working day and night on the issue of dealing with us as they see fit. And it's time that we get involved and get into that game at whatever level we choose to do that. So well done, John. Thanks.
Well, thank you. It's been great that our friendship over these years has brought me to this point and where I have the opportunity to announce the party on Red Ice. So it's a privilege, and I'm feeling that the spirit of the warrior class is ready to blossom. So let's see it blossom.
Very good, very good. Thanks, John. Again, I also want to mention metahistory.org, the other website. Check out Not In His Image as well. Excellent book, of course, by John Lash. We'll have that up as well. Well, we'll talk again more soon here, John. We definitely need to touch base with you again. But great, and thank you so much for coming on. And I urge people to listen to our first interview in this, mini-series, I guess we could call it, that we did with John Lash as well. To get another level of the background of what we've been talking about here, in case you missed that particular program. Lots of good stuff in the archives for you with John Lash. So thank you again, John. We'll talk more again soon.
Yes. Thank you, Henrik. Goodbye for now.
Well, that concludes our radio show for today, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for joining us, and thank you for your interest, passion, and dedication to these subjects, and for having, not only an interest, but also, if you're so inclined, dedicated to act and respond to the troubling reality that we face when it comes to how we are being targeted for extinction. There are, of course, several ways to go about this, and we do encourage all of it, a multiple front warfare tactic in order for us to regain control of our nations and ultimately our world. Please consider signing up for a membership with us. We have tons of shows for you in our archives. The majority of what we do is for free, but please have a look at redicemembers.com and see what we have for you. Thank you so much for your support and for helping us not only to continue, but to expand in our coverage. Please join us again in a few days when we're back with more. For now, we say have a good day or evening.